So hello, ReactConf. I'm glad to be speaking. So I'm going to be talking about how you can live an easy dev life and take a load off with React. So this talk is going to involve some audience interaction. So if you want, head to tindata.now.sh to get ready. I know this is the last talk before the break, but bear with me. It's going to be sick. I might even celebrate with a chalky muffin or a gay time, and you can too. So hey, I'm Jake. I'm a web weaver at Medipass, like the web and stuff. I'm quite passionate about improving developer and user experiences with React, as well as getting my hands dirty with design systems here and there. Feel free to chuck me on Twitter, follow on Twitter if you want to. My handle's joxom_. So what is this talk about? Well, today I'm going to cover some of the common problems we face around data fetching using React today. And I'm going to cover some of the the state of data fetching and some of the tools that we've used in the past, as well as some new and existing tools to help us with data fetching in React. And I'm going to talk about how these tools can help us solve these problems that I introduce. So as web developers, I guess any type of user of an application, we know that data fetching is integral in any type of app. It pretty much powers the dynamic content of an application. But data fetching can be hard, especially managing it by yourself without the right types of tooling. And one of the first problems that we face when integrating data fetching into applications is that representing a finite number of states can be overlooked. I just want to start by visualizing all possible states of a promise. So when a promise has not been triggered or invoked yet, it starts off in an idle state. And then once a promise is invoked or triggered, it then moves off into a pending state, and it can start off in that pending state on your first mount. And then that if the promise resolves or succeeds, it moves into a resolved state. And then when the promise rejects or errors, it moves into a rejected state. And those resolved and rejected states could move back into a pending state if it wants. So there are four main states of a promise that we need to consider when for fetching data. So let's take this example where we're fetching a random dog image and displaying that image to the user. In this example, we're kind of implicitly representing the resolved and rejected states of a promise through the data and error variables, respectively. However, we have no control over the idle or pending state in this example. So why is this representation problematic? Well, the big issue is that we have no representation of a loading state. In fact, there are no representation of any states at all. However, the resolved and rejected states are kind of implicitly represented through the data and error variables. And combining variables to create some sort of state can be hard to read. In this example, we need to combine the data and error variables to create some sort of loading state. However, combining variables to create a loading state is not quite obvious at first glance and can be hard to reason about, especially for a new developer to a project. And it can also produce future problems if you need to represent an idle state. In fact, when I posed this idea to Twitter, I received this response I was expecting. Like, what in God's green earth is that representation? And adding an isLoading variable kind of fixes the problem as we add a little pending state. However, what if we need to do further invocation until later and represent an idle state? Well, we have to combine a series of variables again to represent that idle state, and we're kind of running into the same problem as before. So in an ideal world, it would be good if we had some sort of interface which represents a finite state machine, where if we need to represent an idle state, we can. In this case, we're representing that through a state variable, which can be idle, pending, resolved, or rejected. Another problem that we face when fetching data in our applications are loading spinners. I don't hate on loading spinners, however, it does get quite frustrating for the user seeing spinners that appear for microseconds and even multiple loading spinners on the one page when you're loading different types of resources. And not handling loading spinners correctly can lead to quite a jarring and perceptually slow user experience. And this occurs most commonly when transitioning between pages. And one of the main causes is due to the fact that we're most commonly used to using the fetch on render pattern. I just want to elaborate on data fetching approaches in React, which there are three main data fetching approaches which have been formalized by the React team over the past few months. There's a fetch on render pattern, which we're all familiar with, where we render the component first, then after that initial render, we fetch for our data. There's a fetch then render pattern, which is a less common method, which is the reverse of fetch on render, where we start fetching for our data for the next screen as soon as possible. And when the data is ready, we then render that new screen. However, we can't do anything until we have that data. And there's the render as you fetch approach, which is an ideal scenario where we render the component and fetch for the data at the same time. But I'll talk more about that later on. Let's focus on the most common pattern now, the fetch on render pattern. And that's what we're most used to. So as you can see here, we have like a loading timeline for the fetch on render pattern. And as you can see, it produces a kind of waterfall effect. If we look at the diagram in this image, we can see an actors list page on the left, an actor details page on the right, which, and their respective loading timelines. We load the component, well, if you look at either one of them, they're pretty much the same. We load the components code first, assuming we have lazy loading enabled. And after that, React renders the component. And after that first render, we fetch and display the actors. But wouldn't it be nice if we could load some of this stuff in parallel? For example, loading the code and the data at the same time. Well, hold tight. I'll get to it in a second. Another issue that we can face is visually loading data that has already been seen by the user. For example, in this example to the right, we can see that when we navigate to Tommy Visu's details and navigate back to the actors list, we still see a loading spinner even though we've already seen the actors before. And then if we navigate back to Tommy's details, we see another set of loading spinners on resources that we've already seen before. And as you can see, there's a lack of data persistence in this application. It can also be possible for an application to perform duplicate network requests in a range of a couple of hundred milliseconds. And this can be possible when you're navigating between pages that share the same data or components that share the same requests. But wouldn't it be nice if we could dedupe these requests into the one? We can also run into issues with erase conditions, where if we switch between two data sources, regardless of the order in which we click the source that takes the longest to load will always be shown. In this example, when we click on Jerry Seinfeld, then quickly switch to Tommy Wiseau, it will eventually load Jerry Seinfeld's profile, even though we clicked on Tommy Wiseau last. And this happened because the application has no logic to deal with erase conditions and no logic to disregard previous requests. And these are only a subset of several problems that we face when dealing with data fetching in React with no tooling or abstraction. And in fact, these problems are quite difficult to solve by yourself. And I believe managing these problems by yourself shouldn't get in the way of creating flawless user experiences with React. And in an ever-growing battle for our users' attention, details matter. In fact, 88% of online consumers are less likely to return to a site after a bad experience. And slow-loading websites can cost retailers $2.6 billion in lost sales each year. But there are tools to solve these problems, which is good news. So I did some cool shit, and I made this revolutionary dating app catered for data fetching enthusiasts. It's called TinData, and it'll pretty much help you find your ideal data fetching library. So I want you all to help me find the love of my life by heading to tindata.now.sh. And once you head there, you should see a picture of me with like sunglasses and a little pulsating loading screen. And it should look something like that. All right, let's get our first match. Ooh, local state. He's 25, he's the same age as me. Never ages, fresh skin's always nice. And he doesn't last long. Don't know why you'd put that in your bio. Oh. Anyway, so as React developers, we always lean towards local state to its co-location with the view, and it's easily accessible. And we naturally love having state close to our components. However, local state is indeed local, meaning that the state lives just as long as the component itself. And to achieve data persistence across pages, we will generally lean towards context or Redux or similar tooling to have some sort of global state. And with local state, we can easily run into the problem before where we visually load data that's already been seen by the user. Ooh, looking for another match. Ooh, we have another one. Redux 21, 87 kilometers away. You'll have to be true love if I'm willing to travel that far. It takes him a while to get up and going. It's pretty much like me today. I woke up 10 minutes ago and pretty much ran here. Loves to hold your assets and last a long time. I don't think that's too safe for conference. Yeah, anyway. So for a long time, Redux was and still kind of is a very popular solution to handling global state management for data fetching. However, Redux supplies no data fetching tooling out of the box. And it's up for the developers to handle it themselves. And if not abstracted correctly, they can face quite a bit of repetition and bloat, as well as the problems we mentioned before with data fetching in React. However, there are quite a few Redux middlewares, as well as boilerplates, that attempt to solve these problems, such as Redux Promise middleware and Redux API middleware. Oh, looking for another match. Apollo is pretty laid back and doesn't need much work. I think I'm the same, I think. He's trustworthy and would never lie to me. I think you need honesty for a good data fetching library. But Apollo client was one of the first breakthrough clients which changed the game for data fetching in React. Even if you haven't heard of Apollo client before, it's a data fetching and state management library where you can query and mutate with a GraphQL interface to any type of backend, but has main support to GraphQL facing backends. And one of the best things about Apollo client is it's a fantastic developer-first experience to create flawless user experiences. And these days, Apollo client has a couple of competitors, such as Relay and Oracle, or URQL. And if you haven't checked out URQL yet, you definitely should, because I think the Formidable team are doing a fantastic job at maintaining it. And it's great in terms of developer experience, because Apollo's docs provides you with instructions to install Apollo Boost, which is a package with a set of starter plugins and config for Apollo client. And Apollo's React Hooks library will decode handle your invocation of your query, as well as providing you with the status of its loading state and response data. Ooh, looking for another match. Relay has some pretty sick sunnies, I can see. He loves finite state machines, but not in a traditional sense. It's good to have someone different, because mainstream people are boring. Honest, it's also amazing. So Relay is Apollo's friendly competitor. It's also a GraphQL client for React. You can query and mutate with a GraphQL interface to a GraphQL-facing backend. And it's one of the first, if not the first, library to have first-class support for React's concurrent mode, which is currently in the experimental version of React. And using concurrent mode, we can plug in its preloading capabilities to enable the render-as-you-fetch pattern. So if you remember from a few slides ago, I talked about the fetch on render pattern, which produces quite a bit of a waterfall, as you can see there on the screen, where we have to download the JavaScript first, and then render the actors list component, or actors component, and then fetch for its corresponding data. However, wouldn't it be nice if we could fetch some of this stuff in parallel? Well, with React's concurrent mode and suspense, we can do this and achieve something called the render-as-you-fetch pattern. And with the render-as-you-fetch pattern, we don't have to wait for the component to finish rendering before we start fetching for the data. In fact, we can fetch data as soon as possible and in parallel with the loading of the component. And then once the component is ready, we can show the data straight away if it is loaded. Ooh, looking for another match. It's the last one, by the way. Sorry if I'm boring you. Ooh, React loads. Less than a kilometer away. Is he in the audience? Let's come up here if you want to talk to me, this guy. he loves his dad. Family values are important, very important. But quite recently, there have been new tooling on the horizon which are less GraphQL-y, such as Zeit's SWR, React Query, RESTful React, and React Loads. I'd love to talk about them all, but for this talk, I'm just going to focus on React Loads. And similar to Apollo and Relay, React Loads is a data fetching centric library which provides hooks for data fetching in React. It also comes with built-in data caching and invalidation that comes for free, as well as request deduping, polling, and window focus revalidation. And React Loads also has support for suspense and concurrent mode to support render as you fetch. And with React Loads, you can pass it an async function, and it will give you its response data, as well as states such as is pending, is resolved, and is rejected. And in fact, React Loads' state variables also represent a finite state machine through is idle, is pending, is resolved, and is rejected. It also provides a state variable if you prefer to use that. So just like dating, choosing the right library for you can be hard. But once you find the one, you'll be deeply in love. And if you see on your phones there on tindata.now.sh, you should be able to see the results now, hopefully. So I briefly want to talk about Concurrent React at a high level. It's currently in an experimental version of React, so not quite in a stable release yet. And with a combination of some new and existing React APIs, such as create root, suspense and use transition, Concurrent React allows us to create responsive and perceptually faster user experiences. In regards to data fetching, with Concurrent React and suspense, we're able to prepare the next screen or page in memory and then show it when it's ready. For example, we can show an old screen while we're waiting for the new screen to load with a loading indicator and then transition to that new screen when it is ready. And we can also schedule loading states instead of showing a jarring, cascading loading effect like we saw in the previous problems previously. And scheduling loading states means that we can create a sense of progression for the user. As you saw before, the fetch on render pattern can produce quite a bit of a waterfall effect with our loading spinners. And that's because we're first downloading our code and then rendering the component and then fetching for our data after that initial render. And the fetch on render pattern happens when we fetch for data after that initial render. With local state, we can fetch our data through component did mount or a use effect hook. And with libraries such as React loads, Apollo, Relay, SWR, we could use their respective hooks, which will also be invoked after that initial render. But as mentioned before, we can wait until data on the next page is loaded before we show that page, which in turn enables us to show a loading spinner on the current page while waiting for the next page to load. And as you can see in this example, there is no longer a jarring spinner waterfall effect. React loads and Relay provides us with some functionality to make this work with Concurrent React and Suspense and help us with implementing the render as you fetch approach. We can start to load resources as soon as possible via preloading, which can typically be invoked in your routes or event handlers. And as you can see there in the left with the preload function and the preload query function. And then we can fetch for our cache data from the preload using their respective hooks, as you can see on the right, through use loads and use preload query. So let me explain this with a code example. So here we have our actors list component, where we render a series of buttons for each of our actors. As you can see to the screen grab to the right. Each button has an onClick method where we invoke our handleClick method. And as you can see in our handleClick method, we're invoking something called startTransition, which is a new method in React which pretty much schedules when to invoke the function that you pass to it. In this example, we want to navigate to the next page when that next page is ready. And we get this startTransition function from the useTransition hook, which is a new method in experimental React. And this useTransition hook provides us with a loading flag so we can display a loading indicator while waiting for that next page to load. So route preloading is currently under the works for React Router in version 6, but my hypothetical router called React Router Jake has full support for route preloading. Now, React Router Jake isn't an actual package, so don't go on npm and try to download it, but I anticipate that React Router's API will look similar, hopefully. The idea with route preloading is that you can load data and the component in parallel. And the main thing to look at in this example is the preload prop on the route, where we essentially load the code in parallel with the component, or load the data in parallel with the component. In this example, we're preloading the actor details based on a particular actor ID coming from the route parameters, and then returning the resource, which will then be injected into the component. So I'm going to take our routes file from the previous slide and slim it down a bit so it's a bit more readable. And on the right is a slimmed down version of our actor details component. With our actor details component, we'll be able to access this resource and retrieve the preloaded and cached data through use loads if it's ready. But if it's not ready, which means the data is still loading, use loads will then throw a promise and the component will suspend. And if the component does suspend, that actor details component, that's when we'll see the isPending flag back in the actors list component become truthy, which will consequently result in a loading spinner on the list item itself. And if you want to learn more about this in more detail, I'd highly recommend watching Joseph Erner's talk on data fetching with suspense using Relay at last year's React Conf. So with a combination of Concurrent React and enabling the render as you fetch pattern, we can achieve perceptually faster user experiences. On the left screen grab, you can see the fetch on render pattern, which we're most commonly used to. And on the right is the render as you fetch approach, which gets rid of that cascading spinner effect. So here's another example where we're placing our data fetching logic in the event handler itself rather than the route. So Suspense also helps us with solving the race condition problem by hosting our data fetching logic via resources to the route or event handler level. As you can see, when we click on Jerry and then quickly switch to Tommy, is now Tommy who is shown this time around. And by taking advantage of suspense and error boundaries, we can achieve better loading state representations. Thanks.